Amen. Our God is willing, and if we are willing to be reconciled to God, we know that forgiveness waits. Friend, the good news of the gospel is that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Today is a new day. Let us give God the glory. Jane Guthrie and our children to please come forward.
I want you to look at the bulletin. You don't get a bulletin when you come in, but your parents do. And on the front of the bulletin, it says, "The Way of the World, God's Children." And there are pictures of two groups of people, and they look like children. And we're God's children. In the New Testament, we find out all about Jesus and all Jesus' story. In the Old Testament, we find out about how the world was created. And the world was not an easy thing to create. So to get you in the mood, I want you to close your eyes and put your hands over your eyes so that all you see is dark. Open your eyes back up. And that's the way it was to start with. The world was black and dark, and God decided to do something with that. And so he threw out his arms and he made a world for us. He pressed the dark away and he pressed the waters away and he made pull the earth together. And so there was land and there was sea, and then there was growth on the land, and then there were people, and that's us. And so we are now called the light of the world. And all of the people in here are the light of the world because Jesus left that commandment with us to be the light of the world. So I have something to give you so that you will know that you are the young light of the world. And it's a light. That's yours. You're welcome. Give a light. There you go. Would you believe that's all that I have? All right, on the bottom you can switch it on and off. Yes, you can turn it back on. All right, now let's close with prayer. God, we thank you for these children. We thank you for what you mean to the church to come. Bring them up in the way that you want them to be. Let them be the light of the world in the future. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. scripture today is Psalm 119, 105th through the 112th verse. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to observe your righteous ordinances. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jane. Continuing now with our Old Testament scripture from Genesis, the 25th chapter. Continue now to listen for God's word. These are the descendants of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel, the Aramean, of Paddan Aram, sister of Laban, the Aramean. Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife, because she was barren. And the Lord granted his prayer, and his wife Rebekah conceived. The children struggled together within her, and she said, "If it is to be this way, why do I live?" So she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples born of you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other. The elder shall serve the younger." When her time to give birth was at hand, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all his body like a hairy mantle. So they named him Esau. Afterward, his brother came out, with his hand gripping Esau's heel. So he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man, living in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he was fond of game. But Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was cooking a stew, Esau came in from the field, and he was famished. Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stuff, for I am famished." Therefore, he was called Edom. Jacob said, "First, sell me your birthright." Esau said, "I am about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's stand and sing this hymn based on Psalm 119, number 458. Let's sing it through twice.
Thank you.
ancient Near East, the firstborn son had certain rights and privileges. He was usually favored by his father, and when his father died, he would receive double the inheritance. In addition, the firstborn son inherited the leadership of the family and would have charge of the family, including the family property. The firstborn also had the judicial authority of the father and would receive this through a blessing. He would be responsible for the younger sons, the widow, all the other members of the family. And the blessing that he received would also place him in a special covenant relationship with the Lord. In our story from Genesis this morning, Esau is the older son. Hey, y'all. Yeah, I'm Esau. Hairy and red, and I like to hunt. Big game isn't really my thing. I go after rabbits and squirrels. But my dad sometimes likes venison. So I grab my bow and arrow, go look for them too. I smell like the field because I spend a lot of time outside. Can't stand being cooped up in those tents. Esau was the son of Isaac and Rebekah, a marriage match that God made. Rebekah had gone through a season of barrenness, which was strange given that God's promise was to come through her. But Isaac prayed to God for her, and she conceived. We learn that Rebekah, in fact, conceived twins, and they struggled within her. When she'd had just about enough of that pregnancy, with kids who were tossing and turning in her womb, the Lord explained that indeed she had two, and that the two were nations that would be divided. Jacob was also the son of Isaac and Rebekah. How do you do? Yes, I am Jacob. Mom loves me best. I'm a quiet man, smooth-skinned, and I love living in the tents. Can't stand the feeling of sand between my toes. I stay close to my mother because she's scheming a way to get me the inheritance and my father's blessing. The story today tells us that Jacob plotted against Esau. We don't know if he had help from his mother to do that, but he took advantage of Esau at a vulnerable moment. Jacob envisioned the expansion of property and wealth that having the birthright would give him. Esau only cared about filling his hairy belly. Jacob saw an opportunity and grabbed it. Esau was impulsive and made a bad decision that had long-term consequences. shyster Jacob tricked me. He knew I would be starving when I came in from hunting. So he cooked me a delicious stew. Then he said I couldn't have any till I gave him my birthright. What do I care about a birthright? Did he really think I wasn't going to eat because of a birthright? I know he was surprised when I gave it to him, but I showed him. Don't try to withhold anything from me, or I'll turn you into stew. Later in this story, we learn that it's Isaac who gets tricked. Rebekah wants Jacob to also receive the blessing. So she cooks Isaac's favorite meal, puts animal skins on Jacob's arms and his neck, and sends him into Isaac with the food. Because Isaac is blind, he confuses Jacob with Esau. And when Jacob asks for Isaac's blessing, Isaac gives it to the younger son. Esau finds out. Isaac realizes what he's done. And Esau again loses out on the benefits of being the elder son. This serves to reinforce the enmity and division of these two brothers. Sorry you're so hairy, Esau. It was easy to trick our father because all you do is grunt and eat. You take after our father who likes his stew. And once he had his fill, he was all too happy to give me the blessing. With you gone in the field all the time, it wasn't hard to pull it off. You snooze, you lose. The biblical story tells us that these brothers were in conflict since their conception. And I think this story gives us some insight into the enmity and division that we experience today. The conflict centers on this belief in entitlement. I deserve to have that because I'm a human being and I have rights as a human being. I can say what I want. I can do what I want as long as it's legal. It's the sense people have that the world owes them, even though they've done nothing to earn it. I can steal that birthright, and I can steal that blessing because I should have had them in the first place. The younger son felt more worthy, more special than the elder. And that justified him doing whatever it took to get what he wanted. Entitlement can be the result of spoiling a child, overcompensating for a past wrong. It can be the result of jealousy or a personality disorder. But it leaves the ones who get stepped over feeling taken advantage of and disrespected and angry. And anger provoked by entitlement begets anger. Like Esau and Jacob, we hear, "You can't do that." "Oh, yes, I can. Just watch me." The result of the strife between these two biblical brothers was that Jacob had to run for his life. The anger and conflict was so severe that they couldn't live together. From the start, with Jacob holding Esau's heel, we hear how Jacob is trying to usurp Esau's position. No, I'm going to be born first. But now he is forced to leave home. Bad decisions. Disrespect. Lies. Betrayal. Divided. Brothers torn apart. I hate that conniving Jacob. I hate that loser Esau. You may have seen in the paper this week the brothers who were involved in robbing casinos in Las Vegas. The younger brother, who was involved with the first robbery, testified against the older brother, who carried out two more heists. The older brother was a police officer who probably had a gambling addiction and was severely in debt. What chance do those brothers have at restoring a relationship where one struck a deal by implicating the other? But writer Norman Cohen suggests that reconciliation between Jacob and Esau is possible because they are part of each other's identity. They are like two halves of a whole because they were part of one another. Each needs what the other has. Esau needs the patience and the forethought of Jacob, while Jacob needs the position and the strength of Esau. They are in symbiotic relationship with each other, and they can never escape their bond. Perhaps people born with a silver spoon in their mouth, people who take for granted and disrespect what they've been given, people who think they have a right to whatever they want, they're a little hard to take. Esau and Jacob show us that, like it or not, we are nonetheless part of each other. We still need each other. We can even be good for each other. Whatever conflict exists can be reconciled if we are willing. Reconciliation doesn't happen with one person. Try as we might, reconciliation takes us to occur. We have to want it. Family members can be reconciled if we are willing. Political rivals can be reconciled if we are willing. Churches within denominations can be reconciled if we are willing. Our birthright is in God's family. And God can bring us together as one with God's blessing if we are willing. By the grace of God, may it be so. We are happy today to be recognizing another one of our seniors who is heading off to college. Marilyn Bean will be heading out soon, and to help her on her way, as we did with the others, John Petticord and Rick Rushworth will come forward to present her with one of our educational grants.
Good morning. In the National Gallery of Art, there are these four large paintings in a room by themselves called The Voyage of Life by Thomas Cole. And in the second painting, a young person sets out in a boat on the river of life by themselves for the first time. And an angel stands on the shoreline anxiously watching. And in the distance ahead, there's a glass castle that symbolizes the opportunity and the optimism of the person in the boat. And so today, as Marilyn sets out on that voyage of life, we're pleased to make this financial award to her and to give the award to the distinguished Rick Rushworth.
Well, we're excited to be here again today. And the reason we're here is because our church has an educational grant fund that has gone on for many, many years of people who have donated to this fund. And then it was boosted several years ago by a large donation from the Sugita estate. And that endowment allows us to give grants to students that are members of our congregation. It's not just a grant for the general population, it's bona fide members who have decided they want to further their education in a post-high school experience, whether it's a trade school or a college or even graduate school. Marilyn's going to the University of Alabama at Birmingham, and she's already spent two fairly grueling days down there with Deborah being indoctrinated and all the introduction and everything, and really seemed to enjoy it, I think, but was a little bit overwhelmed by it as well. She is this summer selling drugs and counting drugs to folks in a legal way. She works in a pharmacy. I just want you to know that. That always gets people listening. Yeah. And she's working in a pharmacy. So she's doing summer work that's very beneficial. She might be pursuing a degree in dentistry, maybe yes, maybe not, but she's gonna be a part of that largest college at all universities, the College of Still Deciding right now. And we are very excited for her. She was accepted at quite a few different schools, and she looked around and the process narrowed, came down to this. Her family's very supportive, and we have been truly blessed to see you grow up here and see all that you are, not just what you do, but what you are. And as you know, Marilyn shared with us a month or two ago what her high school senior speech was, and it was very poignant for all of us. And we appreciate those moments. And we'll be praying for you as well as that. And maybe someone will send you some brownies, because that always makes you more popular in a dorm when you have some cookies or brownies. But we're really proud of you, and thank you for doing it. And don't forget to come down here with your family for a picture afterwards, okay? So thank you. Congratulations, Marilyn.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's give her a round of applause. Proud of you.
As we go to God in prayer, let us keep Marilyn and the Noblet family in our prayers, and also Ann O'Connell, who is now back at Story Point but continuing to recover. Mindy Grohman, still at home recovering. Pray for, so glad to have Betty Whitaker back. Betty took a tumble and ran into St. Francis. She can tell you about that. And for Sandy Smith, who's facing some health issues. Any others? We'll keep Lamar Alexander in our prayers. Any others you'd like to name as we go to God in prayer? All right, will you join with me in our unison prayer? Let us pray. Holy God, we were yours before we drew breath, and still we will be yours when the pulse of life ceases. In every fragile, reckless moment, we belong to you. We thank you for the parents who gave us life. May the wounds we carry open our hearts to the needs of others. May the love we have received spill gratitude from our hearts. We lift to you now all that seems irreconcilable in our families, our schools, our nation, your church in the world. We pray for all those in positions of leadership that they may act to keep ties with brother and sister nations in courageous responsibility. Teach us to tend the world you love, sowing more than we reap, healing more than we wound, doing all with abounding love for the sake of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Stand and sing our closing hymn number 372. Friends, as we leave this place, I pray that we might all have the courage to step forward, to be the first to initiate coming together with a brother, a sister we may need to be reconciled to. And if that is not possible, that we will continue to be open and in prayer and receptive for God's love to continue to flow through us, to throw over the wall that rose of hope, that we stay open to God's will for us. May the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ our Lord, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Go in peace.